I want to play the scene from The Fly, because this movie, more than any other movie, made me, I don't know that there's a movie in that period where I was first starting to understand movies that I thought was more incredible than The Fly. And I want to talk to you about it, because we've never talked about it.
Let's talk.
This scene, I mean, I don't know, it was heartbreaking. Watch this scene.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard of insect politics? Neither have I. Insects don't have politics. They're very brutal. No compassion. No compromise. We can't trust the insect. I'd like to become the first insect politician. You see, I'd like to, I'm afraid,
I don't know what you're trying to say.
I'm saying, I'm an insect who dreamt he was a man and loved it. But now the dream is over and the insect is awake.
It's an incredible movie. An incredible, like, first of all, David Cronenberg is a genius, obviously.
I agree. Lovely fella, too.
Just tell me the story of how you ended up in this movie, because to me, part of the thing about this film and I remember being a huge Cronenberg fan in general, but this movie came out right when really the AIDS crisis was starting, and I remember a number of people who were very twigged to the notion that this movie was not about, was a transposition of a famous 50s sci-fi movie with Vincent Price, but that he was reimagining it for the age of AIDS and for the age of now we live in this age of pandemics too, where diseases, it was about a big metaphor for disease and what disease does to people. How did you end up in this movie, and did you recognize its brilliance when you were in it? It's still a movie that's kind of, I think for people, if they watched it now, they're kind of, it's sort of shockingly, it's hard to watch for a lot of people, right? That is hard to watch for a lot of people.
Yeah.
But an incredible piece of art.
I think so too. Well, it's collaborative, of course. David Cronenberg, very brilliant, smart guy from Toronto, and wonderful artist. And he wrote that script, you know. That's a beautifully, isn't that a beautifully poetical?
It's incredible.
Yeah, it's really lovely. And Gina Davis, of course, is wonderful in it. And Chris Wallace won the Oscar for that makeup. So, you know, he was very thoughtful about that. We went over to his place and we tried everything on. He had the stages of the thing. And at that stage, I think it was 5 hours in the makeup chair. So it was very careful and beautiful. The music does something to me in that, Howard Shore. Here's what happened at the beginning. They just sent me the script, as I remember, and I read it. Was he offering it to me as I read the script? Maybe not, but I read it, and I remember when I read it, I was like, oh boy, that's delicious. That would be some part. I'd like to do that. And I had a special affection for Vincent Price movies, too, and for remembering the other, because my sister and I went around that period, saw, you know, Diary of a Madman and Tomb of Ligeia and all that stuff. So I like that kind of thing, but this was something very different. And then I think I met with him, David Cronenberg, and, you know, said how passionate I might be about this and, you know, all that. And there we went.
But you at this point had there been anything? I mean, you've been in obviously a bunch of great movies. I mentioned a bunch of them, like great kind of transcendent films.
Had worked with Phil Kaufman and Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
And The Right Stuff.
And The Right Stuff, yeah.
But you hadn't really had a lead in a film pitched at this level.
Nope.
I mean, this was a movie that I remember, it was a movie that, of course, back in those days would never have gotten an Academy Award nomination for as Best Picture, because it was too kind of avant-garde.
Yeah, genre, kind of.
And genre, too avant-garde and too genre.
Yeah.
But this is kind of a big moment for your career, no?
Looking back, you know, how do you know? How do you ever assess that? And like I say, my focus was always on, you know, my activity, you know, instead of the career. But
did you?
But yeah, I think looking back now, I think that was It was good for me.
It's a movie that's, I just think it's a movie that stood the test of time in a way that kind of is sort of stunningly good. And I guess my question is really, how much you guys spent talking about, time you spent talking about what it was about? Was that a discussion, or was that just all in Cronenberg's head and you had these lines to read and you were kind of playing it straight?
We talked a lot, but it was very collaborative, and I kind of started to get more self-trustful during that period and find myself, you know, and my sea legs, and because I did have a lot of convictions and passions about elements of that thing and the story as it was kind of in a few different places evolving, and I, you know, had a strong feeling about it. And he was lovely and collaborative and a great teacher and a good collaborator. But no, about that, if I'd done it now, if I were to work with him now and do the same thing, I bet I would have asked that question, because I've done that since, and I like to know things like that. It might help, you know. It always occurs to me. So if there's anything in his mind about where it comes from, or his dreams, or his social concerns, or his medical sensibility, or anything like that, it's, you know, it would have been very helpful. But no, as I remember, I don't think we talked about that much.
Listen to my entire conversation with Jeff Goldblum on the Hell and High Water podcast, available wherever you get your podcast, or watch it on YouTube.